Hello, my name is Joshua Aronson. I'm a neurosurgeon at Dartmouth Hitchcock Medical Center, specializing in functional neurosurgery and epilepsy surgery. Functional neurosurgery is the use of technology to restore functions that are lost due to disease. One of the most common conditions neurosurgeons treat is traumatic brain injury. And I think back to a patient I took care of a few years ago, James. James was a college student who was hiking in the White Mountains who slipped down a rock face, suffering a traumatic brain injury. He was brought by helicopter to the hospital, and we operated soon after he arrived. We took him to the operating room to remove a blood clot that was pressing on his brain and remove a piece of his skull, leaving his brain room to swell and let his brain heal itself. James slowly improved, and he was able to leave the hospital after about 2.5 weeks. He was discharged to a rehab hospital where he had speech, occupational, and physical therapy to improve his physical and neurological deficits that he had after his injury. I saw him back about 6 months later. At that point, the piece of skull that we had removed was back on, and he looked like he did before the injury. Unfortunately, he told me he wasn't who he was before his injury. He still had trouble with his speech, with trouble finding his words, had trouble moving his right side, and his cognitive abilities were still not what they were. He wasn't able to return to school. Unfortunately, 2.5 million Americans suffer a traumatic brain injury every year, with over 100,000 left with severe deficits, deficits that impede their ability to return to work or school and care for themselves and their families. We know in brain injury, there are networks and structures in the brain that are damaged, and these networks are responsible for memory and cognitive functions. We also know that we can use electrical stimulation in diseases like Parkinson's disease and epilepsy. We can place devices like this, a deep brain stimulator, into the brain and target structures that, with electrical stimulation, we can use to improve tremor in Parkinson's disease and allow patients to have easier movement. And we can decrease the seizure severity and frequency in patients with epilepsy. So I thought perhaps we could take advantage of our deep brain stimulator technology to improve recovery in patients who suffered a traumatic brain injury. And so I started with a mouse model. And so in a mouse that had received a traumatic brain injury, we tested their ability on a task that mice are typically very good at, spatial navigation, which we've all seen when a mouse finds its way into your house, finds its way to food, and of course can find its way back out again. And so our task was a Morris water maze, a water tank that the mice had to swim around, and on the walls of the tank were various shapes that they had to learn where a hidden platform was under the surface. So the mice would swim until they found the platform, and they had to learn the platform was in the corner between star and triangle. And so I have pictures of our tank at day one and at day five. The mice are placed in the tank and have to find the platform here. In black are mice that never had any injury and didn't get any stimulation. So when they're placed in the tank, at day one, they search around the whole tank, finding the platform. But by day five, they've learned exactly where the platform is and swim right to it. In the dashed red line, we have mice who had a brain injury but do not receive stimulation. And again, at day one, they swim around the whole tank looking for the platform. But still at day five, they have to swim around the whole tank. They have not learned where the platform is located. But in mice that were injured but did receive stimulation in blue, again at day one, they're learning where the platform is. But again, by day five, just like the mice who were never injured, they've learned where the platform is and swim directly to it. And so we saw this dramatic behavior result in these mice and wanted to extend that to human patients. And so we started with patients who already had electrodes implanted in their brain for a different reason, for epilepsy. And in those patients, we looked to see if we could use stimulation in their brain to improve function in these networks for memory, and found that in fact we were able to do so. And so combining results of these studies, we would like to launch a novel human clinical trial where in patients with a traumatic brain injury, we can implant electrodes in the brain and combine that with standard cognitive rehabilitation tasks and see if we can improve recovery from traumatic brain injury with neurostimulation. At the same time, I also direct a rodent laboratory here at Dartmouth, and I would like to understand exactly what's going on in the brain in the setting of injury, what structures and what networks are we impacting. And so I'd like to continue that work at the same time so that we can better refine stimulation and hopefully see even greater improvement in patients with stimulation who have been injured. Also in the Upper Valley, we're fortunate to be able to collaborate with folks at the White River Junction VA. Traumatic brain injury has been called the signature injury of the wars in Afghanistan and Iraq, mainly from blast-type injuries from improvised explosive devices. At the White River Junction VA, there's a facility that mimics blast-type injuries in animals, and so we're collaborating with folks there to see if we can extend our neurostimulation to blast-type injuries and hopefully help our injured veterans. This project is a multidisciplinary collaborative effort. It combines our expertise in neurosurgery with our epilepsy neurologists who understand neurophysiology and are experts in understanding how the brain works electrically, and also our neuropsychology group who have extensive expertise in cognitive rehab. Together, we hope to use neurostimulation to help patients like James who've suffered a traumatic brain injury. I hope you consider supporting our efforts. Thank you.
That's terrific, Dr. Aronson. Thank you so much. That was a great presentation and fascinating research. So my first question for you is, how long do you think it will take for your research in the mouse model to get to the point where it could actually help people like James? And what kind of funding do you foresee that you might need to get to that point?
Well, we are starting with a small pilot project in humans with traumatic brain injury. And we anticipate starting with 10 patients here at Dartmouth. Again, this would be a novel project that has never been done in the country before. And so with the results from that study, we hope to, over the next few years, gather those results and then move on to thinking about how we can extend this broadly to patients with traumatic brain injury, even outside of the hospital, and maybe pair with rehabilitation hospitals and combine stimulation with, again, standard cognitive therapy, just like James had, but when combined with stimulation, perhaps improve their recovery further than they would have without stimulation. And I anticipate hopefully moving forward in the next coming years once we have results from our early clinical trial, which is what we hope to launch in the next year.
So Dr. Aronson, you just alluded to the fact that this would be the first such trial in the nation that we're aware of. What is it that's unique about Dartmouth that gives you the platform upon which to conduct this really groundbreaking work?
I think that at Dartmouth we have a very strong epilepsy neurology group and a very strong neuromodulation group. And I'm fortunate to have excellent collaborators in both of those arenas. And here at Dartmouth, we have been implanting deep brain stimulators since shortly after they were approved in the country in the late 90s. And so building on that experience and building on our epilepsy experience, we're able to combine our understanding of how the brain functions electrically with our expertise in using stimulation to enhance function in the brain. And so I think that we're well positioned because, again, we have these two groups that already come together regularly for projects to look at memory enhancement in the brain. And standard use of neurostimulation in Parkinson's disease and in epilepsy. Again, we're also one of the first centers to use responsive neurostimulation as a treatment for epilepsy. So we've had a very long history here at Dartmouth of using neurostimulation in the brain to enhance function. And so this would be another step in treating an injured brain as opposed to a Parkinson's patient. And I think that we're, again, just very well positioned to do that here.
Well, this is a great example of a collaborative effort that will actually make real difference in people's lives. So we really appreciate your time today. Thank you for coming here.
Thank you.